All right. Hey, we're back. And I got my friend Nate with me.
Hey, guys.
Nate, are we live? Just verifying.
We're going to figure it out here. Here we go. Da, 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 da.
Everything seems kosher. I can see my screen now. I think we're happy.
I'd say go for it.
I think we're happy. Okay.
Yeah, we got people talking. That's
all right, good. Right on. Okay, we are go for go. Thank you, everyone, for hanging tight while we got that figured out. We're ready to rock. So I wanted to just pick up real quick where we left off. On Friday, we were at CBI, and Nate and I took a late drive home. We got home about 2 in the morning after getting the Tacoma and our new Land Cruiser, the 4Runner, a Rufio, all fixed up at CBI Off-Road, and our new Land Cruiser 200 Series, getting it all fixed up with CBI rear bumpers, front skids, front bumper, rear bumper, the nines. And now it is actually back here in Bozeman. Our Land Cruiser has gone over to SCS to get its new season wrap put on. So we'll be over there probably either later today, probably tomorrow. We'll do a live video from SCS on the wrap that's getting put on the Land Cruiser 200, also known as Samson. So, and behind me, Jeff, while we were at CBI, Jeff was cranking on the Tacoma here, and you can see the new TRD Pro grill that our guys from TRD sent us. So now we have the new hood, the new TRD grill, and we're pretty stoked on that. It just really completed the look of that truck. Those TRD Pro grills are pretty special to get. Usually you have to buy a TRD Pro vehicle to have that. But thanks for our hookups at TRD, we got that stuff outfitted for us. So anyway, yeah, and you can see the snorkel that's on it now. Rufio, the snorkel is complete. Of course, you kind of saw that last time. Skids are all underneath it. The new aluminum sliders from CBI. That's kind of good to go. Rufio's kind of good to go for the expedition, other than some power management stuff that we're doing on the inside of Rufio. We're beefing up the batteries there, because Rufio is where all of our offloading happens at the end of a day. So we'll be filming, Nate will be filming, we'll be putting a bunch of data on cards, and then while camp is being set up at night, and food's being prepped, and gear's being going over, the trucks are being going over, we have another guy that is sitting in a truck right there with the computers and hard drives out, and he's just offloading and organizing all the footage every single day. From there, it gets split into 3 drives every single night, redundantly into 3 different vehicles. And then during the next day, those hard drives travel with the show in each truck. That way, if one of the trucks goes down, something happens, we're not losing the whole show. It's redundantly backed up between the 3 vehicles. So that's what happens in there. That takes a whole bunch of power. So we're beefing that system up. So, well, this episode is titled Gear because this trailer came in with Paul May of Equipt Expedition Outfitters. And he's inside. Let me walk you in real quick. He's inside and he has brought his 200 Series Land Cruiser, which is pretty red. Hello, Paul.
Hey, Clay.
We have been working on a whole bunch of equipped gear for this next expedition.
Yep.
And we've got it all laid out on the floor here. And we'll go through it all. We'll give it a once over. So, but first I wanted to show you his pretty cool 200 Series Land Cruiser. This is a 2013 LC200, am I correct? 2013.
Yeah,
2013. And I'm not gonna show you too much because we just filmed and in the shop on this. So we're gonna, when those come out from May into June and July, you'll see this one in full detail on what we did. But one of the coolest things right off the bat that you can see here is the new Stealth hard shell tent from Ezion. It's got an aluminum hard shell and is in crazy fast how that sets up. So
nice, yeah.
Yeah, pretty cool. We are not taking one of these on our trip. We're staying with the traditional style, but that is a really sweet tent. So anyway, back to the task at hand. We'll swap it here. All right, Paul, let's walk him through this gear. So, every time that we go on a new expedition, we're always swapping gear and we're refining our equipment and getting things just so. And also with sponsorships, we change the gear out from time to time because of the different things that certain sponsors are wanting to show, the newest, the latest, the greatest, the whatevers. So one of the big factors that we're working around this year in changes is the XV3 trailer. Now we have a little bit of experience with it because we did the return to McKinsey with it, but that was a prototype trailer. And that went back to Shutt Industries and they've tweaked it, and our new one is actually in process of being built right now. So we're having to kind of do some, street math here on making sure that everything fits. Yeah. So let me show you how we're kind of going about that problem solving set. So what we did when it comes to the XV3 is we mapped it out on the floor. We did all the measurements for the interior dimensions of that XV3. And you can kind of see like what we've started to figure out with the Aluboxes. The height is actually just a quarter inch taller than a jerry can. And that was a strategic decision when we were working with the XV3 trailer design, because that's one of the tallest things that you'll put in a trailer. And trying to keep the size and weight down, we did know that it had to at least fit a jerry can. So that height, which is 19 inches, is what we based everything around. So now we're working with making sure all the Aluboxes and the different organizational systems fit around that concept. So the reason we have this mapped out with a front bar is because we're gonna be lining 6 jerry cans across here. That's how we're gonna be carrying our spare fuel. And that can change a little bit. We could carry water there and whatnot, but last time, we're waiting to see what it comes back, but we had a water fill nozzle right here in the trailer floor design, and it kind of got in the way of the organization of jerry cans, so it looks like they've got that moved. The other thing that we experienced was we had some fuel fumes that went down into the water tank that was underneath the tank, and for a day or so, we were burping some pretty nice gassy water fumes. We could light our burps. It was pretty awesome. Not really. Anyway, so this is the system that we've come up with so far. It's a working model. So what do we have here for cases, Paul? You're the master.
Okay, we've got up the bottom there, that's the ABS-74 is the name of that one. It's a low profile, deeper, wider case. So that's a pretty good size for just about anything you need, low, flat, and long. That works out well. And what's nice about it is right above it, that case on stacked on top of it, that's our most popular case. That's the 42 liter, ABA 42. And two of those will stack on top of that 74 perfectly. So they stack well and they seat well and hold themselves in place with those cast corners on there.
Yeah.
The one just to the left of it up here in the,
this
in
one?
The front. Yeah, that one there is the 73 liter model. The 42 liter, the 73 liter, and the 60 models all have the same footprint. So they're all the same length and width,
yep.
But they vary in height. And that 73 is gonna fit in just under the threshold of the height of the back.
Of the back.
Of the case there.
Yep.
The next one over, the one behind it, that is, the model is called the 115 liter model. And if you notice, it's the same height as that 73 liter model. They made it very modular that direction. We're going to put two of those in that space,
yep.
Front and back, which I think is going to work out really well for us.
Yeah, and so just to be clear, this is the mock of how the trailer is going to look, the inside. This is going to sit right there, in theory. This is all in theory, until we actually get the trailer here. And what that allows us to do is there's latches on this side, and we could access the contents inside from standing outside on the trailer. So you're not actually having to move these cases. You can roll the cover back and access the stuff that's inside. Plus it's contained because trailers take a lot of abuse. And that way everything's not loosely random rolling around and getting destroyed over time. So yeah, we got one of those and we're gonna have another one right here. This one, remind me what that one was again?
That is the 70, oh God, what is it? 74 liter model. ABS 74 is what it's called.
Okay, so that box lived on top of our Tacoma in the Central America season. And we used that for all of our stinky shoes. And that's, you gotta put that stuff somewhere, right? So that's what that box is for, and that's what it's gonna be used for again down here. And then two 42 cases sitting on top. There's gonna be two people that get to live in this 1600 series, or series 3 1600 rooftop tent that's gonna go on the roof rack of the trailer. It's gonna sit up here. So those two people that live up in that tent get two 42 cases, and that's gonna be holding their extra gear, like down coats, jackets, gloves, things like that, that when we get further south, we're gonna need, because we're going to be pushing into the fall, pretty much from the time that we get into Peru all the way down to Patagonia. We're gonna be in actually colder climates, not just the jungle like we were in Central America. So each person will get their boxes right here, and that'll allow them to quickly access them from the side of the trailer. We're thinking that this is gonna work really pretty well. And then this box is gonna be used for probably storing food and hauling dry food around for everybody. Now the tent, or excuse me, the table, this, we got some slides, and it's gonna slide underneath the roof rack and underneath the tent. Why that's important is a lot of times when you get to camp, the first thing you need is a table. And most of the time, if you don't plan it very well or think through it very much, it's the thing that's buried the deepest. Yeah.
It's always on the bottom. Yeah.
It's a better idea, if you can, to keep your table as accessible as possible. So we're going to be storing it underneath the rack. It'll slide right out. We'll be able to be stood up, and then you can get your equipment out, you can get your stuff and not set stuff down in the mud, and you're not, yeah, it's just it's the small things, but they matter.
It matters a lot. And this, what I like about this mount that that Ezion put together with the table, if it looks familiar, it's the same production that National Luna uses for the lids of their fridges.
Oh, that's true.
So it has the same dimpled aluminum or stainless steel on it,
yep.
Which means that we can go with a thinner metal. It's a very lightweight table. And what we do is we take that table and we invert it upside down and slide it in the mount. That
okay.
way, all the legs are on the upside of the table area when it's in motion. And because the tent's going to be over the top of it, it's going to stay nice and clean under there, and it's going to work out really well.
Yeah. And being stainless steel means it's food grade too, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Not a problem there. Just back on it, on another note, you were talking about the Aluboxes, and I saw a note or two coming through about the Aluboxes and the seal, what they've got in them when you open up the lid. Here, I'm going to go into
it. Yeah. Go for it.
This around, when you open these up, the top edge right here, it's a silicone bead that goes clear around the entire lid of the case. And so when that lid comes down and you use the cam lever on here, you've got a lot of positive force on that. And what that does is compress against that silicone bead. So that is a water resistant, dust resistant case. You were talking about this case. I had this case on my 100 series and 4Runner for 5 years, carrying all of my recovery gear. I never got a drop of water or dust or a speck of dust inside that case in the 5 years. And then I sold the case with the 4Runner. So we'll probably do something like that on the 200 years sometime too. So really nice cases. They do the job. They're a buy once, cry once kind of case.
That's they are. Thing. They're, you know, probably the most common other box bought at this price range would be the Pelican case.
Yes.
And I used to define my manhood by how much Pelican cases I have. I have changed that since. It is how many Aluboxes I have now, because it's so James Bond. But anyway, going to the Alubox versus Pelican, they are significantly better when it comes to space. pelicans, though they are a great case, but they have a lot of plastic and built up.
Yeah, very much so. You can run over them with a truck. Sure.
But do you really need that? And our trucks are already really heavy, so we've gone to this case system where they stack so easily, so efficiently. There's not hardly any wasted space, and they weigh very little. I mean, they're so light.
In consideration of the of the weight that you're already starting with on a Pelican case, you can start out with a anywhere from 6 pounds to 20 pounds a case before you even get the product in it.
Yep.
Where these are only running only, you know, 3-4 pounds a pop to start with.
So yeah. Is this one empty? Yeah. Light
single finger hold and lift. And long term, the Pelicans and the screw cases and the other ones that are out there, they do hold up to sun quite well for a while.
Yeah.
But long term, they do start to break down. You get discoloration. It's not that the case is going bad, but they disfigures the case and discolors it.
Yeah.
There's no UV requirement issues at all on the aluminum cases. They just take it and beat it. One of the things that I've been asked quite a few times is about heat absorption. And does the case get hot if you have it on the roof for long times or periods of time? I haven't found any serious temperature variance in the case in the middle of the Utah deserts or Alaska or where have you. I just haven't seen any dangers of anything inside the case being affected by the temperature of that case. I don't know about you, Clay. Have you seen any?
No. They just actually, and usually like Pelicans, they're black and then they start to hold the heat.
Yeah.
That's been a non-issue with Aluboxes.
But I think too. I think they're just a better solution for exterior specifically, but interior as well.
Yeah, I would agree.
So I think your layout here is going to work out incredibly well for you. Easy access, easy mobility. You can configure it the way you want, change things around to the application of the day. So it's a good idea.
Yeah, cool. We got one more thing that is being added to these as well. We use these as tabletops and seats. That's the perfect seat. So we're always trying to have products and gear serve two purposes at least, if possible. It either has to serve one absolutely mission critical purpose, or it has to serve at least two or three other purposes. So a tall one like this works excellent as a mini table or a step up. We use another one just like this for the step up into the back of the Tacoma to get into the habitat. And this year, Goose Gear has built
stairway.
Yep, look at that. Boom, boom, boom. And they're strong enough. And Goose Gear has built lids that are coming for these that allow them to even hold up to even more stepping and standing on over the time. So, yeah, we're pretty stoked about all of that stuff. We're always big fans of Aluboxes. This is the back to the quick tent. This is the 1600 series. On Apollo and Rufio in the previous season, you've seen us use the 1400 series, which is just slightly narrower, right? It's
between 6 and 7 inches narrower.
Okay, yeah. So this one was going to fit on top of the rack. Awesome. You know, very precisely. And we get a little extra room out of the deal. So
yeah, that's going to be nice. Just shy of a queen size bed and width. So it does give folks a little bit of extra wiggle room to get around. And it's a lot more comfortable to have that extra space, especially if you have the tent down at a lower mounting point where stuffing that extra material in isn't as big a conflict as being up on the roof.
Exactly.
Yeah, definitely.
So coming down, if we look down here, just a couple last minute things. This is the rack for Samson. This is the extrusions that are, well, they go in the factory mounts and we'll mount the rack.
Yep, the rail that mounts to the roof line, we take the factory rack off, and the rail that we mount to the roof line, it's the same as the forerunners that are that you guys are using. Honestly, this whole rack system is literally the same rack with different mounting points for the roof rail.
Sure.
So once you put the rail down, we add feet and put the rack right up on the top of it. For the 200 series, because the taper of the 200 series, they narrow the taper of the roof line in. The roof line's about the same width as the forerunners are right now. So we offer two different sizes for the 200. This is the narrower size. We thought it'd be a lot more uniform with what you guys are doing in the filming to keep them all very consistent that direction.
Yeah.
It does look really good up on there.
Cool.
It works really well.
We're excited. My battery is getting a little low here, so I'm just gonna run through a couple quick things. This is the new Swift awning. A single person can open that out. It's freestanding.
Yes, in no wind.
In no wind conditions, which is awesome. If you're gonna have a quick lunch, it folds out and you can sit under an awning quickly and put it away. We have that on the clone vehicle that's on the auto tour with Toyota, and it's great, great, great awning. And I wanted to just give you a sneak peek. Goose Gear put in this system in Paul's truck, and we have replicated it for the most part. We're not doing the front. Paul has it so that you can sleep in here, but we had ours extend all the way over to here and down so we can use this top area for shelving. And so you're getting a sneak peek of what's to come for our Goose Gear setup, which we're really excited about. We're not putting a fridge in ours. It's going to be used for Pelican cases, for helicopters and stuff like that, or our drones. But in the future, we did put this in so that we could fit our fridge slide in there in the future. So a little bit of future proofing happening, which is always good. Paul, thanks for coming up.
Absolutely. Glad Hopefully to be a that, part of it.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, sure.
You came all the way up from Salt Lake to Bozeman to get all this stuff sorted out. We got a bunch of other gear that will be... I'll swap it here. We got a bunch of other gear that we'll be bringing in the future. But this kind of was what we're working on today. So anyway, thanks for joining us. Let's answer a couple quick questions if we can.
Interesting information.
Good question.
There. Okay. So up to this point, as far as mounting the Aluboxes to the roof line, you only had a couple different options. One was to strap it down either with some tie-down rings to the, like the canine rack or some of the other slotted racks. You could put some rings in there and do some ratchet straps, and that does okay. The most common way of doing it was literally drilling through the bottom of the case in the four corners and putting a bolt up through there, and you put a stack of fender washers on the top of the bolt to take up the recess area on the bottom. You have the case, and then what I did is I put a neoprene fender washer over the top of it, fender washer over that, and then a nylock nut down, and you could bolt it down and leave it there. Perfect. Yep. Nobody's ever going to take that.
They're not taking it, and that's what we did on our cases.
Right, and so here's a little bit of forward-thinking insight. I met up with the guys from Alubox and from Easy On over in Abenteuer and Allrad over in Germany last summer, and we've been working on developing a mount for a select set of the Aluboxes that have a consistent dimension. We're building a bracket that will mount not only to the T-slot style Expedition racks, but we'll also have an opportunity for bolting to a round tube rack or anything. It's going to be a base plate. Then you can lock the case into place, lock it down based on the lip, and removable, which is going to be a game changer as far as mounting these things in here. We've got one coming over as a prototype. We're going to be staring at it here for a little bit and hopefully have some of those mid to late summer. Hope to have some of those in stock. So that's going to be a really big change for us to be able to make them portable cases mounted on a roof rack. So stay tuned for that one. That's going to be
cool. Next question.
Are the Aluboxes lockable?
Yes, and here's the theory behind that. Sorry, Clay, I'm just taking.
No problem. Go for it, and we'll show them. Do we want to show them too?
Yeah, we can show them. That's a good question. So the Aluboxes come on the face of the Alubox. They have a nifty little pad spot right here. That little plastic thick clip there, and what that's for is a paddle lock. You know, one of those little things. You turn the key, and the key goes like this.
Mm.
Even Alubox says not to use those, and the reason why is because you can take a screwdriver under here, pry it open, and that little piece of metal that's that movable piece just simply bends out of the way. It doesn't work well at all. And so what we suggest is on each side of the handle here, there are a couple holes. You take a medium or small size master lock, run the barrel through there, padlock it on. Absolutely safe. You can't pry that off of there. I use one lock in each handle. I've got some pictures of four locks on there, but one lock per handle, it's gonna hold that thing in place and you're never gonna have an issue. Never had anybody try to get in there. They'd tear the case apart. If they want in that bad, it's gonna happen regardless.
Sure.
But as far as holding that case down and lockable, that's the way to go. Master locks.
Keeps the honest guy out. Yeah. We've all the way through Central America, we had all of those on top of our lids. you know, and that's one of the most more feared areas of, you know, theft and things. Never had an issue. Worked great. Next question. I saw one question. Who is this man? He was asking, who is this? This is Paul May of Equipt Expedition Outfitters. He asked if you have a channel. The Wily Elusive. So, one more question, because I don't know where my battery's at.
Fuel, is the gas tank capacity factored on the 200 series?
Is the gas tank capacity factored?
Yes.
Of course. Yeah, it's we're running just on a stock fuel tank. Right now, we've got a couple guys that are chasing long-range fuel tanks of some sort, but we haven't been able to source any yet. So that's probably coming in the future, no doubt, but it's just not here yet.
Definitely something I would love to have.
Me too.
I miss my long-range tank in the 100 series. Yeah. That was impressive. Love that thing.
It is really one of the best accessories, things that you can put on, is just having maximizing your range. When you're really going out and doing this stuff, that's one of the more important things to have. But
what's the best roof rack to use?
What's the best roof rack? Well, we're a little biased here. That's a trap. It's the K9 roof rack. I really do think so. We've used them all over the place. There's a lot of good companies out there, but the K9s, just the accessibility or the usability of them, being able to mount a bunch of different accessories on them through the channel slots. The rungs run lengthwise with the vehicle, so they have less wind noise. They're ultra light. They've been proven all over the world. They're a really great solution. Any more? Let's go one more.
Yes, sorry, I lost it.
No problem.
Do the rooftop tents interfere with satellite radios?
I haven't found that there has been any issues with their reception on those. The spacing of the layout, depending on the rack that you use, the 1250 millimeter wide or 50 millimeter or 50 inch wide ones have 5 slats, and the slat goes right over the top of that shark fin on the 4Runners. Then we put tents on top of them, and we put all sorts of stuff on it. I don't know about you, Clay, but I haven't seen really that much issue.
Not much.
Every once in a while, you get a little bit of a fade, but it comes right back. You get a quarter of a mile down the road.
Yeah.
On the 1400 millimeter rack, like what I'm running on mine right now, that has 6 slats, and so the antenna actually ends up going in between 2 of the slats. It has a little bit of room here, but then I stuff this really nice aluminum tent on the top of it. And with the stealth tent on there, no issues with range at all that I have seen. So it's a really good question. Some folks are worried about that. We've had one customer that couldn't get the radio, or not radio, but the weather channel through his system.
Okay.
That was a concern, but across the board and the hundreds of these that we've got out there in the market right now, I haven't heard any more issue about.
Some of it depends on where you are in the country too, and the satellite angles and things like that. But
yeah
not really an issue for us. It hasn't been so. One more. Oh, we got one more.
What's the fuel range on the 200 series?
Right now, we're anticipating that it's going to get 14 miles to the gallon, towing a trailer fully loaded, and it has a 25.5 gallon tank, if I'm not mistaken. So 14 times 25.5. I don't quite know what that is, but 250, 300.
You're getting about 350 out of it. With my experience pulling the my AT Chaser around with this with full kit, I'm a little bit of a lead foot, and I'm getting in the 12 range.
Okay.
12 to 13.
So maybe we should budget on 12.
It's part of the Millennium Falcon, you know, bat out of hell kind of thing. I tend to go fast. So yeah, I would push down your numbers just a mile or two.
Just to be conservative too, especially in budgets.
Exactly.
When we're looking through fuel budgets and stuff. All right. Well, thanks, Paul. Thanks for coming.
Glad to be here.
And thanks for joining in with us. We'll have another live video as soon as we have something interesting to talk about. We're going to try and be pushing this out on Facebook and on Instagram before we go live. So look for that. And then if you please subscribe, it'll send you a notification in your email and on your phone that we're going live, so you can catch us when we're in the act. So catch you later. Thanks.